Now we are live. Today is March 3rd, 2016. Welcome everybody. Hello, Brin, Makiko, Michelle, Tina, Valerie, and Zane. I'll start with a little blessing and meditation, and then we go. If you want to introduce yourself, we'll go around just to engage. If you don't want to do introductions, do the blessing. If you don't want to do the blessing, talk about whatever your questions, bring up the questions about DNA and stuff. So first I will do a little. So I will sing for you a piece of beautiful DNA sequence. This is one of the newest insertions of the human genome. Every one of you, everyone on the earth has it, but it's very fresh. It's very new, very modern. It is inserted, it's 300 nucleotides, 300 letters, and it's inserted in many places, and different people and different races have this sequence in different places of your genome. So this sequence, I believe, defines the new human vibration, or maybe new human alien vibration. It's called ALU YB8, A-L-U, letter Y, B-8. And just to give it a name, by some reason, I wanted some neutral name, so the neutral name would be Granada. It's like easy to remember. It's a town in Spain, a city in Spain, and let's call it Granada, so to refer to it. And I will sing a piece of it, because 300 letters is about 5 minutes to sing. There are many ways to sing it, so I will sing it in a simple chant way. And for you to engage, send it love, accept it. It's you. It's one of your highest vibrations. Connect it to your crown chakra as the highest vibration. It's still a human vibration, but it's very high human vibration. So connect it to the crown chakra and pick the color. Yes, and combine it with purple. Pick your favorite color and combine it with purple. And the letters are G, A, G, C, T. Now introductions. If you want to skip, just say I want to skip. So I'm Max, and I have many names. I'm present here as Steinberg, and I do DNA and a little bit of channeling and live speaking galactic languages, like listen to galactic languages. And we have here a humancolony.org community, and our new site is hucolo.ning.com. And I had some other announcement. And I'm now in San Diego. That's the announcement. I'm in San Diego, and I would love to connect to our people in San Diego and Los Angeles and in between. So connect me to those people. It would be fun. And I have here now three meetups. One meetup is a Reiki meetup, Reiki and channeling. It's called Reiki and Channeling. human colony Reiki enchanted. Hey, Caitlin, didn't see you for a while. And a couple more meetups. So, and I go to other meetups and do Reiki and stuff. So, and I recently went to Conscious Life Expo and met David Wilcock in person. That was fun. And I saw Stephen Greer speaking from the stage and a few more people who I knew before. Mm-hmm. All right. Caitlin, are you there? Can you speak? All right, Makiko, would you like to introduce yourself or ask questions or whatever?
Sure, I'm Makiko. I'm a Reiki practitioner, and I also recently took the cranial sacral therapy, so I could add that to my repertoire.
Uh-huh.
And I'm so looking forward to going to Asheville to build a tiny house.
Uh-huh.
Yes, and I love
Asheville,
doing
which Asheville?
Asheville, North Carolina.
Oh, wow. I love Outer Banks there.
Outer Bank? Oh, yeah. Who wouldn't? Mm-hmm. And then I love DNA, so I'm so fortunate to connect with Max, the god of DNA. Woohoo!
Thank you. Who wants to go next? Caitlin, can you speak? Caitlin says she has a lot.
Hello, Max.
Yay, nice to hear you. I didn't speak for you maybe for a year or so.
Oh, yeah. Well, I've been just living life, and that's the reason why. How are you?
Nice to hear your voice. I'm good. I'm now in San Diego.
Oh, okay. That's awesome. It's nice to see that you're doing well and everybody else is.
Nice to have you.
Oh, thanks.
Hi, Max. This is Valerie.
Yes. Hey, Valerie. Nice to see you.
Reiki 2 now, thanks to Max.
Wow.
I'm practicing that. And also, I'm a seamstress. You can see that behind myself, all my sewing machine and stuff like that. So I run a little company at home called 406 Upcycled. And Makiko recently purchased a beautiful coat for me. And there she goes, advertising for me.
Wow. Show it again. I will show it on full screen.
This one is called the Violet Flame. So I try to incorporate my spirituality into the sewing as well.
Wow. Yeah, I want one too. Give me a good deal. Let's discuss after the webinar. We'll see.
Max. I make men's as well, and there's nothing wrong with having the I can't remember what they're called now right offhand. It just slipped my mind. But you know the guys that spin in circles, the spinners that do that for enlightenment?
Mm-hmm.
That's what they're modeled after.
Wow.
Yeah. So any
colors? Yeah, I would like something to officiate those webinars. Maybe something DNA patterns, Tree of Life patterns, and it would be like something like religious style, but New Age religious style.
I got you.
Oh, maybe we can start with the head. Maybe a head would be a new
head.
And
I think
little
Max
small
for you,
I
believe.
See this one? It's a little small for me. I ordered it in Israel, but
and you like that pattern in the colors? It's beautiful.
So yeah, I want purple and orange.
Oh, you got it. Those are beautiful colors. Beautiful colors. Yes, I can do that for you, Max. And because you are such a wonderful person that taught me Reiki, and well, I just love you, Max, it'll be donated to you.
Wow. Thank you. It'll be great.
My pleasure.
All right. Oh, who else? What else? No. Nobody did that. Who wants to introduce themselves? Bree?
Yeah, sure. Hi. My name is Bree. I'm excited to be here. I don't know how long I can stay, but I've been listening to a few of these DNA things before, and I loved every little bit of it. It's incredible information, and it's obviously so important for us to really start to understand, and Max, you do such a fantastic job at disseminating the information. I don't know what it is about how you talk, but it just, like, It resonates so highly with me. I love it.
Thank you.
So, yeah, to introduce myself a little bit, the only thing I want to bring up here is the fact that I'm helping plan this first Scientific International Global Pyramid Conference coming up in Chicago in May this year. And so that is what I'm doing full-time, nonstop, also working full-time. So I'm probably going to be talking about it a lot on the side. So if anybody's interested, let me know. But
what is the essence of that? The name doesn't say much.
It is scientists, researchers, archaeologists, and others coming together for the first time internationally to discuss the hard facts, the hard science behind what they found with the pyramids and why they're here and what they're doing and their power to heal and transform, heal the environment, decrease radiation, you know, heal us, help with meditation, all that great stuff. And then
Like you're talking about homemade pyramids, not Egyptian ones.
We are talking about all pyramids all across the world, including homemade pyramids, especially talking about architects that are making their own pyramids. There's actually a gold pyramid house tourist attraction that's right in Gurnee, Illinois, right near where Wendy is, kind of near where the conference is, and we're going to be taking a tour there, talking to the guy who made that. I mean, there's just so much information. There's people, vendors there for crystal energy and for, you know, energy healing, Reiki. We're going to have...
excuse me, Brie, where is this at?
People talking about in the ancient civilizations, all that great stuff. Yeah.
Where is this going to be at?
I'm sorry?
Where is this located?
Oh, it is going to be right near Chicago, Illinois, in May.
Oh, Max, you just left there.
Again?
I said you just left there.
I left there. I didn't plan to come back soon. Yeah. But how, if people want to find it, what's your website or webpage?
It is globalpyramidconference.com. We are trying to work on improving it. There's lots and lots and lots that needs to be done. So it's kind of like we have a tiny team effort right now, and we need all the help we can get. But mostly we just want to bring people there who are helping for global ascension and, you know, humanity's evolution and really being able to get back to our roots and understand our real history instead of all the kind of nonsense that has been talked about.
Sure, no nonsense. I wish to help you in many ways. And the first one is if you want to do webinars with us and tell us more about the pyramids, that I think would give you a new platform to advertise, basically. People would love to hear more of science, more of experiences.
That would be great.
It kind of help. Who wants to speak next? Tina?
Yes, hi. Hi. My name is Tina. I actually live in Canada.
I love Canada.
Yes, me too. for the last 10 years, I've been living, well, I had a husband, and he was Native, and I have Native roots. I am Abenaki, and I've been practicing the traditional life, and we help each other out, go to Sweat Lodge, perform the pipe ceremonies, do a lot of prayers for other people. It's the real traditional way, and the name came to me, like my spirit name. My husband always said, your spirit name, it's not someone else that's going to give it to you. You're going to receive it from the spirit, from the creator. And there was a time where Native people didn't say their spirit name because they said that some people can use it against you or use bad medicine against you. And there was an elder, a Cree elder from north of Canada that told me recently, she says, you know, now is a time to say your name. Now is a time to open, to share who you are with others and not be afraid, because that's what brings us down, is that fear. It takes away our power. So my spirit name. It's an old polar bear woman who sings in the clouds. I do native crafts. I also do my own ceremonial items that I need. I made a owl wing here.
Wow.
And I'm a moon dancer, which is, I don't know if you ever heard of sun dance. That's the man ceremony. But the moon dance is the women. They dance for 4 nights. They sleep a little in the day and then they get teachings. But it's the reason for the dance is to bring light to the darkness. So basically you get in touch with your shadow self, but you don't push it away. You learn, you fall in love with yourself and you accept every part of yourself. So you become balance. That was very good teachings for me because I had cancer. I had uterus, cervical cancer, stage 1. And the doctor asked me if I wanted to wait, cut, burn. What did I want to do? I said, I'm going to wait because I'm going to beat this on my own. I know how. And it wasn't just diet. It was also how you think. It's how you feel. And it's basically talking to your DNA, talking to your body. And it'll listen to you. You got to create that mind-body connection to be able to get that healing you need. So I love philosophy. I'm very optimistic, maybe a little idealistic at times, but I love learning about anything. So that's me.
Wonderful. Thank you. Nice to meet you in this way. And we have Zach, Zane left. Do you want to speak?
Was that me? Sorry.
Yeah, would you like to speak about anything?
Yeah, definitely. I met Makiko just this winter. It was actually on New Year's Eve at a party, a New Year's Eve party. And I was sort of in the middle of going through a personal transition that began with Steve Greer. So I think it's cool that you got to see him talk. And so then he kind of cracked the door open in terms of investigating or reinvestigating, I should say, the UFO and ET phenomenon. And the conclusion I came to by reading his autobiography was that there's a sort of necessary spiritual evolution that comes along with that transition, that comes along with sort of fighting the establishment, so to speak. And I thought that was just so cool that from the material, I arrived at the spiritual, you know, and that there are people who are working on both fronts. So that's kind of how I got here and on this wavelength. And since then, it's just been this exponential increase in information flows. So I feel like I'm in a whole new headspace, and it's an exciting time, so I'm glad to join you guys and learn what I can.
Wonderful, thanks for sharing, and nice to meet you in this capacity. All right, I think we are done. Michelle gracefully skipped her turn. I think we don't have anyone else to. Right, Valerie, yes, everything said, everybody. Okay, all right, so I think I want to go with new information, and before I start with lots of new information, I want to give you some basics. How about that? Some basics about DNA. And for that, I need to share my screen, and that should be easy. Google Hangouts, this one. So you'll have many of me, I guess. Let me see what happens. Yep. All right. So that's where we are. And let's start with searching for DNA. And you will get lots of images. See images. Can you see the images?
Yes.
Hey. Yes. And what's wrong with those images? It's all not real DNA. It's some sort of simplified, designer modified DNA. Very few of them are real. So this, can you see, I will show you this one. Where is it? This one. Can you see it? Can you see it?
Yes.
Yeah, that's more or less correct image of DNA. So it is a right turn spiral, double spiral. So it's a right turn, like if you raise your right hand, then that would show the direction of the spiral. Right hand goes forward, and then you kind of twist, following your right hand. And if it's left-handed, it's not from Earth, it's some imaginary DNA. And I believe even aliens have right-handed DNA. So that's kind of our reality has that one. Now, and most of, like lots of the DNA is like here, the first one, left-handed, not real. This one is left-handed. So the painters, the designers, they don't really care, you know, if they just show the real DNA or not so real. So this looks very scientific, but it's not right. It's left-handed. You see, left, it turns the wrong direction. This one is pretty, but it's a wrong step. It's like very stretched. Maybe it exists, but it's left-handed and it's a wrong thing. Like here, what's wrong with this DNA? Can you see this? Is it visible? Can you see it?
That's good. That's
yeah.
Good.
So what's wrong with it? First, it's left-handed spiral. And second, the steps there are equal. And they are not really equal. The true DNA, so this one is real. This one is true. So this one, it should have about 10 steps of this basis between the turns. So one turn is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, about 10. So 10 steps is good. And I'll go back. I need to show you
something. Excuse me, Max, when they say a strand, what are they referring to?
They use it with different meanings. So let me show you. So this is the most classical image of DNA, right? And sometimes, like typically when people say strands, they mean these blue ribbons. Blue ribbons are strands. So it's two strands connected to each other. It's called, strands is used as one of the linear molecule, a chain of nucleotides. And two of those strands form a double helical DNA. But when people who don't really kind of are not careful about the words or don't know the words, they can use, you know, a DNA when it's combined, it's also like a linear sort of, if you look from afar, it's a linear spiral, and they turn the double, to name the double-stranded DNA as one strand, basically. They combine them together in one. And sometimes people confuse their DNA molecule with chromosomes, and then they call the chromosome the strands. For them, it's all equal. And some of them confuse the DNA with protein, and it's, you know, it's all for them the same. So it's not the same thing. DNA and protein are two different things. DNA is one chemical, and protein is a series of other chemicals. All right? So DNA is made out of four letters, four monomers, and then they are A, T, G, and C, adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine. And usually there are two strands which are close to each other, and there is a place for a third strand. Can you see it here? There is like a sort of so-called small groove and big groove, or minor groove and about major groove. So you see the space for the third strand here? It's kind of very mysterious space. It's always there, and sometimes it's occupied with proteins, sometimes it's occupied with water, and maybe it is occupied with DNA or RNA, sometimes small pieces, but usually not. So it's a very mysterious place, and I don't really know what is there, but I think it is there for a reason. Maybe there is something happening, like molecules of water maybe structure and stand there forming some sort of a laser crystal which could transmit light. which I don't know. It's kind of a fresh hypothesis. I don't know if it's true. But this DNA is, you know, we work with it daily, so we really know it's of that structure. It's right-handed spiral. It's double helix, and it's pretty. We're pretty confident about its structure. Any questions so far?
Yes. Where's this third space you're talking about?
Yep, major groove, space for the third strand, yes.
So is it on any one of those crossbars with the AT or the G? Or is it like on the corner as it turns?
Oh, you don't see it?
No.
You see the can you see my cursor? No?
Yes.
So when the space is right here. When we see the cursor, my the arrow of my cursor, can you see it?
It's in the black.
What do you mean in the black?
It's not on the map.
Not like on it. The picture.
Hold on.
Okay.
Should be able to fix it somehow. Hold on. How do I do this? I know how to do it. Hold on. Okay, I can do it. Technology is okay. The third strand is right here. See, that's the place for the third strand. See that?
No, because now I don't see your mouse. Sorry. So.
Oh, you cannot see it. Okay.
No, so maybe you can explain it with words. Is it?
Yeah, I would just play with buttons better. I'll use the technology to fix it. Hold on, stop. it's fun. How do you share the full screen? I can do it. Start share. Now I go back here. And print screen, blah, blah, blah. And now you should be able to see it. Hold on. Right here. That's the strand. Can you see it now?
Oh. Okay.
That's the place for the...
Okay.
For the...
Gotcha.
Third...
Okay.
Strand. It would fit right here perfectly in the major groove. You see, okay. Two strands leave a space. And true DNA always have that third space, mysterious third empty space.
Okay. Thank you.
And the nucleotides are here, like that would be G, that would be C by colors, you see? Okay. Now let's look at these nucleotides. They're beautiful. They're wonderful. So nucleotides tied pairs. And look at images. Ah, they're so beautiful. That is it. That's how they look. And one of them, I will draw on the screen, right here. And one of them would be, this one's called purine, and this would be either A or G. They have two beautiful kind of circles, if you can call it a circle. And again, it's a pentagon and hexagon, wonderful shapes. And this would be pyrimidine, and it would be T or C. And you know the difference between T and C is very small. So basically, the pair is either AT or GC. So it's either A, T. They pair together, and they hold in a beautiful fashion, they hold with hydrogen bonds, or they called G and C. And they always pair. So that holds the two strands together, these pairs. And now I need to show you the stack of... Any questions so far? Good. I'll show you the stack of nucleotides, of base pairs.
Are these the structure, is this what the structure looks up that makes up the two strands or the three strands or the ones that go across or all of it?
No, two
strands. So that structure is here. So you see this double helix?
Mm-hmm.
Those nucleotides are, print screen, All right. Here, so it would be, you see it's a long one, it would be the G or A, so it's G, C. And this long one would be either A or G, so I pick a G, A, T. And they hold the strands together.
Okay, thanks.
And they are responsible for wonderful coupling of the strands. So that's when the cells divide, one strand goes to one cell, one other strand goes to another cell, and this continues duplication of the information. So when you copy the DNA, one strand C, it becomes G in the second strand, and that makes it like a Xerox machine, very precise, perfect Xerox machine, copying one strand to another. So to duplicate, you basically double the DNA, copy it, make a copy, and then they separate into different, the chromosomes are separated into different cells, okay? And that's well studied. We are absolutely sure in our reality it is absolutely true. So these base stacks here, you can see they're very pretty, and they form a crystal. They really do, a liquid crystal, linear crystal. So let me see more pictures of it. Nucleoside pairs. Done with that. Stack of base pairs. Okay. I want it pretty. This one is pretty. This one is pretty. Oh, this is beautiful. So that's the shape of this crystal. You see? That is the structure. The green one. You see it? And hello? Anyone there?
Yes.
Okay. So you see the green balls?
Yes.
So the outside is the outside backbone. It's called backbone. And inside are those base pairs, AT, GC. And let me print. So these are wonderful. So this is a liquid crystal. That's the one. And we know for sure it is a semiconductor, so it conducts electricity in the DNA. It's real, it's absolutely proven. The hypothesis is it also conducts light. It hasn't been demonstrated yet. It might conduct light, but it is a crystal. It could be a laser. And it's very likely to conduct sound. So it is a nice crystallic form which can be conducting things within the cell. Any questions so far?
So it conducts our electromagnetic energy or just electricity?
All right, so a little bit of physics. Electromagnetic is the waves usually, the wave where electric field is converted to magnetic field and back. Let me show you. It's important. When you talk about light, we really know what it is. Okay, so. So how do you say electromagnetic wave? Okay. And here it is. The first picture is perfect. So that's the image. So when we talk about the fields, electric field is converted to magnetic field and back. So we have electric is like pinkish, and magnetic is bluish. And they kind of create each other. And they go hand in hand in two perpendicular planes. So what is electric field? Electric field is the one which pulls the charges, electrify your hair and the things that attract, that's attraction between the charges. It's electric charge. So electrons and absence of electrons are charges. And electric current is when electrons move. So, but when the electrons move, they don't create the magnetic field. When they accelerate or turn, which is also a form of acceleration, that's when they create the magnetic field. And magnetic field is something which is like the Earth has magnetic field, the magnets have magnetic field, the phones produce magnetic field. And when you make a vibration of either electric field or magnetic field, this vibration creates this electromagnetic wave, which either can be a standing wave, standing in a place, or it propagates, and it propagates with the speed of light, whatever, in the vacuum, whatever frequency is, it always propagates with the speed of light, which is 300,000 kilometers per second.
So is that what we use when we do Reiki?
Wonderful question. I'm confident that it is not. I'm confident that that way which we use in Reiki is beyond the physical space. Electromagnetic is still physical, and Reiki is certainly beyond the physical. It is not measurable by modern devices. At least, you can buy the device.
Buy
a device which measures it. Sometimes some devices might be able to measure, but I don't think it's very real. It's a different topic. So most of our devices cannot measure. The physicists, if you give them $10 million, they won't be able to measure the Reiki energy. So that's the simple answer. How do I know? Very simple. Let me show you myself. Hold on. Stop here, and can you see me? All right, so when I send a Reiki energy, it takes me a little meditation to activate my hands. So I invite it, and it starts flowing, and it flows kind of, with meditation, it flows better. And then I move my hand farther, and I still can feel this ray of energy hitting my palm, and I can feel a little blow on my hand. I can feel it because I am conscious, right? Now, and I reach that level of vibration. Now, it behaves like electromagnetic ray, but if I go underwater, which I did for experimentation, by definition, the water would change the direction, it would change the angle of that radiation, and it doesn't. I know for sure. I did many experiments. If Reiki goes through clothing, it goes through metal, through the walls, it goes the long distance, which I experienced on myself, and electromagnetic energy doesn't do that. Whatever frequencies, even gamma rays, they don't go that far, and the ray usually fades with a very fast. It's the intensity of normal electromagnetic ray fades reverse proportional to square of distance, meaning if you have 1 foot, it would be one energy. If it would be 2 feet, it would be 1/4. If it would be 4 feet, it would be 1/16. So it fades really fast. And Reiki doesn't. I can go far from the patient, and the effect is almost the same. When you put the hands on and there is sensation, there is a more effect because there is a feedback, basically. You feel them, they feel you. There is a unity which is through sensation, through touch. But it doesn't mean that the Reiki energy is different. It's just additional consciousness connection, which makes it stronger. So the answer is no. It's not physical. It's not electromagnetic. It is called differently. I like the term ethereal, and that is the term which is used by many scientists. There are also names for it: a thin energy, zero point energy,
quantum energy.
Yeah, physicists wouldn't like the term, but
no.
quantum mechanics is a place here, a big way, but in a different way. The word is not just. It's
not ready yet.
Misuse. Quantum is a particle, right?
Or a wave. They did the study.
It's either quantum or a wave. Quantum is a particle by definition. Or quantum theory is a theory about tiniest particles and how they switch back and forth. And in quantum theory, there are basically the idea that particles can link, link together, and then when you separate them, they're still connected to each other through information. So,
yeah, quantum entanglement. Yeah,
entanglement. Yes. So you have to pronounce little more than quantum. But it's okay. It's up to you how to use it. I like ethereal. Ethereal sounds good to me. And I just kind of, you know, we use the terms which others use. I don't want to invent new terms. You know, it's not necessary to invent new terms at the moment. All right. So I'm still here working on the DNA. So that's the first level. Now let's look at, how do you call it? I need to show you the screen. Sorry. Show you the screen again. Full screen, share screen, full screen, share. So I want to show you the, how do you call it? DNA, chromatin. So the keyword is chromatin. And here is a beautiful picture. Let me pick the classical one. I guess this one is good. Wonderful. That's a classical picture of chromatin packaging. How do I view full screen view? Full screen. That looks good. Okay. So, can you see it? I need a feedback. Can you see it? All right. Yep. So, the top, you are familiar. It's a double helix drawn by a professional scientist or supervised by a professional scientist. It's two strands together, right-handed helix with about 10 bases per turn. Do you see it? Let me show that. 10 bases. Okay, 10 bases. Let's count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You see, it's about right, 10 bases. I think it's 10 and a half. I mean, it depends how coiled the DNA is, but it should be about 10 bases with the default most popular structure. All right, so that's double helix. Now, that double helix has to be packed in chromosomes. And the chromosome is that thing at the bottom. And it's pretty big. It's 1.4 micron or 1400 nanometers. It's pretty big. It's, you know, you can see them within the cell with a microscope. You cannot see double helix with regular microscope, but with regular microscope, you can see chromosomes. They don't always, they are not always visible in the cell. They are visible only during cell divisions. So the cell basically unpacks the DNA. How do you describe it? Say, you brought home your homework, you take it out of your backpack and put different pieces on the floor and kind of work on your homework, it's all unpacked. But if you need to copy everything and then divide it, so you need to copy, you go to the Xerox, make a copy of all your homework and create a new backpack, and then you kind of separate them into different cells. So that's what the cell does. It condenses the DNA into individual chromosomes and then separates copies to one side and another side of the cell and then kind of separates. So it's in the cell division. I guess I have to show it. There is no other way. Are you familiar with that picture of cell division? Chromosome, cell division, chromosomes, cell division. I don't see a pretty image, but I guess it would do. All right, so in the first picture, the DNA is right here. It is sort of unpacked. You see? And then DNA is condensed into chromosomes here, and then they duplicate it, and here they are separated, and then the cell separates, and the chromosomes kind of separate into different cells. So that's how all the life on Earth functions.
Wow.
All right, so DNA is absolutely important. It is a program, it is the code which is duplicated every cell division. All right, going back to the idea of chromatin. So, the idea of chromatin. So, the DNA is very little, 2 nanometers, and then it's very long, it's about 2 meters per cell. And it has to be packed in this little chromosome, right? Can you see it? So the difference between DNA and chromosome is that DNA is basically a substance. And when you talk about DNA, you think about double helix. But then that substance, the double helix, is packed into the chromosome, which is like tightly packed. 2 meters in a very small volume. All right? So now it is packed through process. So that is well known, that process. It is DNA is packed into the kind of its roles. How do you define it? Can you name it? I know it's in Russian. I just don't know English. Like the knitting, you put the knitting onto the cylinder. How do you call it? When you do the knitting, the sewing. The thread, you thread around turn the thread around the cylinder. How do you call it?
A spool?
Yeah, spool, exactly. The spool. So these nucleosomes are the spools. They're made out of protein. And interestingly, DNA is charged negatively. It has extra electrons and it is charged negatively. And these spools are charged positively. So they love each other. They kind of attract the DNA. When they mix them together, they roll around themselves naturally. DNA just loves to roll around them. So they come together in a beautiful structure. Now, that is known, well established. We can map it, blah, blah, blah. We can measure it. Lots of labs are doing that, mapping it. What is new, which is my hypothesis, not yet proven, is that when the current, electric current, goes through the DNA, electricity, I believe it could create a magnetic field. So there would be a magnetic field right here. So that is new, and it's yet to be proven, but I think it can work as an electric magnet. And if it starts oscillating, if you put alternated current through the DNA, naturally, if it exists there, then it would create magnetic processes like vortexes or electromagnetic things, and then it would become a transformer between the electromagnetic field and the sound. So it would create sound waves and electromagnetic waves in the cell, in the nucleus. It's still a hypothesis. All right, so what happens next? Next, we have those packed in a zigzag structure, which is called 30 nanometer fiber. And that's, I think, it is the main antenna, the main resonator of the, one of the main resonators of the DNA structures. I love it. I think the secret is there, how it is packed and how the sequence within this DNA becomes a wave. I think that structure creates a very interesting wave, and I believe it might create vortexes of electromagnetic energy, very focused vortexes, which then would somehow interact with the etheric field. Yet to be proven, yet to be studied, it's still a theory, a hypothesis. Then those are known to be packed in this structure, which doesn't have even a name, 300 nanometer zigzaggy snake.
Looks like a wave, yeah.
Yes, yeah, wave, lots of loops, and those are even packed even more. I don't think this one is characterized well, and then it's formed in the nucleus, in a chromosome, which is visible. So lots to be discovered here. We can work very easily with double helix with the initial sequence of it. We can map the nucleosomes. They're called strings, beads on the string with the spools and thread. And 30 nanometer fiber, there are a few labs that study it. It's not well studied, and people don't understand the importance of it because they don't understand yet the importance of the vibrations of the DNA. So, and the chromosomes are well studied. People look at them mostly for genetic defects and for birth defects and stuff like that. They kind of look at them and see if all of them look pretty and study them pretty well. For practical reasons. All right.
Now, so,
yes?
It's so interesting, Max, because looking at the top ones, when you showed that, immediately it made me think about motor windings, right? The way you're saying a spool of a very thin filament. And then down below, the chromosomes remind me very much of an antenna, sort of a classical like TV antenna or something. So it's both of those are very interesting if we're talking about electromagnetic energy.
Absolutely. The condensed ones, yes. But remember, the condensed one exists only a small part of the life of the cell. In most part of the life of the cell, it is decondensed. It's kind of a messy, invisible solution where you cannot really map much. It's DNA fills the nucleus. Let me show you.
Okay, thank you.
Hold on, I will show you the fish. It's called DNA chromosome, DNA fish microscopy. It is beautiful, actually. Actually, that can be shown on video because people now can show how it happens in real time. But basically, so these are condensed chromosomes with some parts fluorescently labeled. Okay. How to get out of here? Doesn't let me out. Strange, isn't it? Okay. All right. And this is actually very representative. That's when it is decondensed. You can label different parts of the genome, but you can't see the chromosomes. It's nucleus. So the nucleus of the cell is full of DNA. It is somewhat structured, but it's kind of not as structured as chromosomes. So I think the resonance happens even there. But when you look at the videos of what happens in the nucleus, how these things move, you see they move with certain pattern, but it's not crystalline pattern. It's very fluid. So it's still yet to be discovered how the resonance shapes things there and how things behave there. It's not simple to prove that there is vibration and resonance. But, you know, when you look at things moving in the cell, it reminds me like a city at night. Cars move. Everyone has its own purpose. You can see when you fly over the city, you see the cars moving. Everyone has its own purpose. And some cars move slow, some cars move very fast, and some, like police trucks and emergency trucks, go opposite to traffic, and everybody lets them through. You know, that's what happens within the cell. Every component of it seems to be intelligent and moving, you know, about its own business with very nice precision and direction. So lots to be discovered. Any questions more on this topic? Any more questions on this topic? So ALUs, ALUs. So the DNA sequence contains unique parts, and it's 3 billion nucleotides per cell. So our genome is 3 billion nucleotides, so 3 billion bases. And out of it, about 50% are unique sequences. Basically, if you know the sequence, you map it on the genome, it would happen only once. Like most of the genes we know are unique. And there is also lots of repetitive parts. And repetitive parts comprise about 50% of the genome, and my favorite sequence called Alu is present there in million copies. And I expect, my hypothesis is that the Alu is the vibrational antenna of the genome. Basically, it has certain structure and it would make the network of the vibration in the nucleus. And there are a few other sequences like line one, also about a million times per genome, and some of others. And say Alu comprises about 10% of each of the genome of each cell. So I think it's a very important sequence. So we need to study it. It's not well studied though. It's studied, but not as much as others. All right. So resonances. Obviously, we look for resonances. You know the resonance, right? Oh, the I will switch to my image. Hold on. How do I do this? Stop. Hello there. So the resonance, when one thing is vibrating, the other one starts resonating with the same frequency. Also, it's called entrainment. When one is vibrating with a very strong, forceful energy, the other one would vibrate with the same energy, even if it doesn't want to. So people can entrain others, or the music can entrain you in a certain vibration. So the influence of music works through entrainment. And the resonance is just when two things are... So entrainment is forceful resonance, and resonance is just when two or more things synchronize. All right. So I believe the resonance is important. There is the idea of holographic body, or etheric holographic body, and there is a hypothesis that the DNA creates that holographic body. So that the cell, when it is in the body, it knows its coordinate by referring itself to the holographic image of the body, to ideal image, and behaves accordingly. And when the sickness comes, it first occurs in the holographic field, and then it translates or materializes, manifests, that's the word, manifests in the physical body. So that's why Reiki works, because we don't work on the physical body, we work on the holographic body. We work with the DNA, we restore the vibrational patterns, and then that translates in health. The pain goes away and stuff. So that idea, I think, is very strong. Again, it's an idea. It's not science, scientifically verifiable, because we work with something which is unmeasurable, which is etheric field. I don't believe it is electromagnetic. I think there is electromagnetic vibration there. I think there is sound vibration. But when they meet around the DNA in those vortexes, when they kind of focus, they transcend the physical reality. They go to ethereal reality. And that's where the magic happens. So we still need to understand the whole thing. And I think it's understandable. There is lots of experiments to be done. But now we go to the area which is beyond experimentation, at least beyond that simple experimentation. Any questions so far?
No questions. I was just thinking that bead on a string, that picture you had earlier, and you had said that the middle of it was positive, like the
charge. Yes, poles were positive. Yes, they're called nucleosomes. Yes.
Okay, and then the next picture after that, there was a whole bunch of spools all put together in series and parallel at the same time, like when you put batteries on that way to have more power.
Yes, it's called 6-millimeter fiber. Yes.
Okay. So that's what I was wondering. I said, geez, electronics has the same basis when it puts batteries together to create more of a charge, you know, to have more power going through. It's connected in series and parallel at the same time. The human, we're mimicking our human body when we're creating these electronic things.
yes, absolutely. So another idea of sickness is that DNA... I guess I will tell you in words before, because pictures are just slow. So DNA can be modified. The typical modification of the DNA is when the bases, one of four bases, you have A, G, C, and T, one of them is C, it can be methylated. So four bases, only one can have a methyl group, a little tiny methyl group, which is CH3. So it can be attached, and it's called methyl C. So we have four bases and one modified base. And lots of our DNA is methylated, and it's called epigenetic modification. So AGCT is genetics, and on top of genetics, epi is epigenetics, and this methyl sits there, and it's a punctuation mark, and usually it says that this part of the genome ought to be sleeping, doing nothing. So methylation usually means turn off that. So when you turn off too much, you become old, or you become tired, or you just turn off things and slow down. And actually, the process of unmethylation is very limited. You basically don't unmethylate. If you turn off something, it's off usually. It's really hard to unmethylate things in the cell. There is no easy process for that. So methylation is easy. Unmethylation is not easy. Methylation is great for fighting cancer because you turn off the cancer, turn off the things which are suspicious, and they just sleep. So lots of humans have lots of cancer seeds everywhere from ultraviolet, for example, and they just sleep in there. It's proven. It's well known by medical profession. So turning off things is good. It's another level of controlling and regulating things.
The cause that it turned on in the first place, you know what I mean? Like if you have these sleeping cells, like cancer cells, and the cause that caused them to awaken in the first place, that's another area. It could be stress, could be your body's not pH balanced, it could be, you know, could be different things. Yeah.
Yes.
I don't know if this is true or not, but I was just reading that sound can change your DNA as well.
Uh-huh.
Sound frequency.
Yeah, I'm looking at that. I welcome any input. I'm kind of researching that area now. Sound, ultrasound, that's infrasound, would be nice.
Sound and color are supposed to be together and do have a huge impact.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, much of that is serious science. Much of that is hard to reproduce. It's kind of spiritual science. So again, it's you know, going into detail is important. But what I wanted to mention in response to this, what is causing cancer? There is a theory, again, of sickness being a negative energy attacking your etheric body or your holographic body. And I think it's pretty strong. It's very convincing that bacteria, now the mainstream science discovered that, I didn't read the paper, but I heard that they understood that it's not sufficient to have one bacterium to infect you, or 10 or 100. Sometimes the critical mass is about maybe 10,000. So this that is very interesting. So there is a collective behavior of bacteria which is needed to reach a critical mass to get the infection going.
Yes, I study that a little bit too.
Mm-hmm.
It's called quorum sensing.
Quorum sensing.
You can't just have a one, but they could be sleeping. But then having a mass, like you said, a certain number, they begin to communicate sensing. It's a quorum sensing, the field of energy produced, and then they all activate it simultaneously, and it causes the effect. If you type it, quorum sensing, there's a...
Go type it. So, yes, thank you. Yes, so the idea is that there is collective behavior, and, you know, for mainstream scientists, the first hypothesis is always chemistry. So maybe bacteria collectively produce some chemical which helps them to wake up. Or maybe they monitor how many of them are there, and they say, you know, I'm here. All right, there is 1,000 of us or 10,000. We are ready to attack. And then they say, all right, go, collectively. And the second idea is that it is vibrational. So, and it's very popular in Russia, that idea, that there is some vibration that is which is produced by the bacteria, which can break a hole in your vibrational field. You have like protective shields, and they kind of break the hole with their energy, and then they kind of squeeze their ethereal program, DNA program, ethereal DNA program into our DNA program, or they violate our holographic field or trick it into allowing them to grow there.
Wasn't there a scientist in the 1930s, Mr. Royal Rife or something like that, and he had discovered that every bacteria had its own frequency, and he could use this device that would cure cancer, cure ailments, just by pointing the frequency at that bacteria, basically to deactivate it or something like that. Royal Rife.
Yeah, I think it is classified. I think they, you know, the military or whatever, underground military kind of took full control over the technology. They hunt, they still hunt anyone who has a machine, and they prohibit all the, you know, they close all the research and publications on that. So it's really hard to go in that direction. But yes, that's the idea is there. It's really hard to find any proof that it's real, but the idea is there, and it would be nice to have simple experimental experiments on model organisms, basically, to verify that. Yes, absolutely. Royal Rife, yes. Very little scientific proof is there. It's more like idea yet. Again, with the cancer cells, the same idea, that maybe they produce certain disturbance in our holographic field, which tricks it into allowing them to grow. Basically, it tricks the immune system from shutting them down. Another idea I had, it's still fresh, I don't know what to do with it, but basically the fact that Homo sapiens extinguished all other primates which have similar genomes, maybe because we were fighting for etheric holographic field, so collectively humanity creates our own field, and if other primates exist in that field with the different genomes, they kind of interfere, violate it, negatively affect it, so maybe it was fighting not only on physical level, but also on ethereal level, so we didn't want any other close primates to exist. The monkeys have survived because they're pretty far. But, you know, Neanderthals and others, they were extinguished. It really made, like, our ancestral warriors angry when they saw some others from other species, and they kind of extinguished them one way or another.
Max?
Yes?
You've ever heard of the study, and it's proven scientifically that every 7 years you are physically a brand new person because every cell in your body has died and regenerated a new one.
Yes. It's about, yeah. I would say, go ahead.
So an idea came to mind when I was reading about that. I said, well, if they have a lifespan, like every cell has a lifespan, just like every human being has a lifespan, then what if every cell in our body had its own consciousness? They had a job to do. And just like in the masses out there, if you start an idea that spreads like wildfire, but it's not good for society, it's kind of like how a cancer cells grow and then convinces the next cell beside them, come on, join me, and it's like a revolution in your body. And then it's how do you, you know, like my visualization, my meditations was to send an internal psychologist to go and speak to my cells and bring them back to the right way. It was a funny meditation, but it worked. That was one aspect of the human being that I helped in healing the cancer. Because we have four aspects. We got the physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual, or ethereal, like you were saying.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Yes. Cancer in human society, it's like Bolsheviks in Russia, right, who created the revolution. And then extinguished most of the body. It survived, but barely. Or fascism or something like that. Yeah, fascism is a typical cancer. It was obvious to everyone that it was negative, but somehow it tricked everyone to go in within, except Churchill. All right.
It goes with your idea, too, that the cancer cells, they kind of camouflage themselves with this shell, this protein shell, and made the body, like the immune system wouldn't attack the cancer because it made the body believe, like in one study, it made the body believe that you were pregnant. So it wasn't going to touch that part of you. It wasn't going to destroy it because it was new life growing inside of you. But what the immune system did not know is that these cells, they could grow without oxygen. They could grow with the... There's two types of sugars. There's a natural one, and there's the one that's synthetic, and one is like charged positive, the other one's charged negative. And one is good, it's complementary to your body, but the other one is not. So that's how the cancer grows if you put all that synthetic sugar in your body. I read a lot on the cancer because I had it, so of course I got interested in it. So
the idea that cancer tricks the body to think that it is a pregnancy, I think it's a great idea. So it's already in mainstream, people already know it?
Pardon me?
Is this idea already mainstream, it's already published?
It is talked about on, there was doctors talking about their theories. Yes, it was published doctors, yes.
I like it. I think it's about right, at least for some cancer. I think it's about right.
Yeah.
When you say the body replaces all the cells every certain number of years, it's most of the cells, but not all of the cells. There are cells which are quickly being recycled, and there are cells which are slowly being recycled. There are germ cells which live, you know, for the all fertile life, so, we keep the germ cells.
Like our flora in our intestines.
No, the germ ones are the sexual ones for which create our progenitors for the children.
Okay.
And also there are stem cells which, they are not being replaced very fast. They are very kind of kept protected, packed. Even radiation doesn't affect them much. So they become used once in a while, like, I don't know the example of that, but maybe if you had some sort of seeds which you would then make your crops out of the seeds, you would keep your stock seeds very protected in the fridge, and then take a little bit, and for this year you would multiply them, and then for next year would multiply them.
A slow release system when you need it.
Yeah, so I know the blood cancer, all the blood in your body is descends from one stem cell every 4 years. So people who, like the doctors who work with the blood cancer, they say, if you survive long enough with that population of cells, you wait for next 4 year period, maybe next progenitor cell, next stem cell will be healthy and you'll be good again. So that was an interesting observation alert from that. So that's another example. Okay. I want to switch gears to the next topic, but please go ahead if you have more questions.
I actually had just something I wanted to bring up on this whole topic of frequencies and everything is I recently learned from a conference speaker who is going to the Global Pyramid Conference that he, through his research, discovered that pyramids hold the 192 natural frequencies that are needed in life that align with all the chakra systems of the body and the world and everything, the universe, and that is one of the reasons why when you put living organisms or crops or whatever it may be in a pyramid and especially near the top of the pyramid, it actually helps to heal because it is reintroducing the proper frequency that helps all of life, essentially. And so I just wanted to throw that in there because I feel like that knowledge in and of itself is going to be huge for our collective advancement, especially for the medical industry becoming what it needs to be to support us globally. And with all of this energy healing and everything, it's like, because I recently healed myself from Lyme disease with energy healing, energy clearing. And that's the only reason I'm, like, doing any of this stuff or even in this webinar right now is because I came across that protocol. So it's like, this is our future, and it's just very interesting to kind of relate all of these topics. So when you're talking about DNA and everything and the frequencies, it's fascinating to me. So I was wondering if you had any ways you wanted to expand upon that with the 192 natural frequencies or any of that?
It's a big topic about experiments on pyramids. I would refer everybody to the book by David Wilcock, The Source Field Investigations. He has a big chapter on pyramids, and I think it's a great summary. Have you read David Wilcock's book?
No, I...
You should. It's not that long. It's maybe 50 pages, chapter about pyramids, and he has very nice summaries and ideas how it works. I worked with one of the experimenters with pyramids, and they are able to focus the energy from growing green plants to... So in that case, I mean, they do it for humans, but they also did it for... some experimental they use nematodes as experimental model, and they showed that they survived much longer when they received the focused life energy. So I know it's there is some nice experimentation done there. I wanted to ask you again, what was, like, you mentioned the protocol for Lyme disease we used to clean you out. What was that protocol? What did you do?
So there's a lady named Candy Vandewalker. It's Candy with a K. I coincidentally came across her protocol after delving into conspiracy research and everything when I first started Awakening late last year, so it's been very quick. And she was talking about how she had this terrible Morgellons disease, nanotechnology, yada yada. I don't want to go into it right now, but it is also related to Lyme disease. And I think it's all spiritual tests, which I guess everything is. But anyway, she almost died. And she was led to this information, and all it is you are taking the frequencies of the words, because words, thoughts, everything, even written words, spoken words, hold a frequency. And so the protocol is you simply have to print out words of the topic you're trying to clear yourself from, or think it, or say it, whatever works, and then hold them in your hand, tap your spine up and down about 8 times is what she recommends. It doesn't have to be exact, and that's just turning on your central nervous system to, quote, download the frequencies into your body, and then you just have to know that this is going to help clear you of these frequencies. It's basically just clearing the chakra systems of blockages, of sensitivities, of these energies. You hold this paper in your hand, or think the word, or hold the item, tap your spine up and down, and then you do acupressure in a circle around your body. It takes about 3 minutes, and I did that 3 days in a row, and the fourth day, after doing the bacteria clearing for Lyme disease and all these other bacterias that are commonly hurting a lot of us, I woke up with no fibromyalgia pain for the first time in years, and changed my whole life, and I've been better ever since. Now, You know, it's something that is good to do every once in a while. I'm not saying that like doing it once helps permanent, but I mean, it has changed my whole life, and so it's you can just search for energy clearing protocol on Google. If you type the name in Candy with a K, it comes up right away. Her website is on acalltoaction.com. I'll post it in the side chat, but it's amazing. So
I got it.
Yeah.
It
works for everything, not just Lyme disease. You know, it's food allergies, cancer. I mean, it's a step in the right direction to helping your body heal itself. She's not saying it's the end-all, be-all. You know, you obviously have to have proper nutrition and all that good stuff, but this is huge for helping people start to heal, and it's what helped me. So I know it's able to help others, too.
So the key words are confirmations, affirmations, tapping, and acupressure, right?
Yeah.
The tools which are combined in the new system, which is the name of the system?
Energy healing protocol or energy clearing protocol. Mm-hmm. They're the same thing. She's labeled them both. It combines quantum physics with acupressure, and it helps clear your body of sensitivities and blockages of energy that's holding you back from achieving your dreams.
Thank you. And now I wanted to switch to next topic. I am running out of time, so I will be brief. But I think I just learning new stuff, and I wanted to share it. It's related in many ways. It's relevant in many ways, and it brings things together. Thank you. So I'm. How is the sound? Can you hear me fine? Huh? So I'm listening to lectures by Russian teacher Manosov, M-O-N-O-S-O-V, Manosov. And it's on YouTube free in Russian. And he's teaching a traditional ancient, mostly Atlantean course on magic. And it I learned a lot from that. Basically, he puts together a lot of things in a very harmonious way. So the main core of the teaching is that the idea of chakras, that's where he found my resonance. It was he defined chakras in a new way, and it made tons of sense. So the chakra. We know seven chakras from Reiki, yoga, and from Lightworker teachings. It's everywhere. Chakras. And he defined it as a frequency. And that frequency is basically frequency of nerves going from the head to that place. And he says that signal, back and forth signal, or vibration goes from the head to the place. Just a second.
You're muted, Max, for me.
Yeah, Max, the sound went out on your mic.
Nothing yet.
And now it should be good.
There it is.
All right.
Welcome back.
So basically, he says the division of chakras into seven levels is artificial. It was done at the ancient times, around the times of Atlantis, before the first destruction of Atlantis. It was a creation of those magicians. They were very advanced, and they created the whole, the whole system. They created the system. So we have the spine, and the spine was divided into seven areas, and the first area is farthest from the brain, so it takes longest time to for the nervous impulse to go up and down, and that creates the longest vibration, the slowest. And then it is shorter, and it is shorter, and it is shorter, and it is shorter, and it is shorter. And the highest would be somewhere in the top, right, the crown chakra.
So that's why the lowest one is red.
Right.
Because
Yes, the lowest is red, and actually it goes up to violet. And you know what I learned from another place? Violet is actually is switching to the next octave, switching to the next seven. So it's already violet has some of red. That red comes from the next level. Violet is close to red. It's like blue mixed with the next level, red mixed violet. All right. So the seven number, go ahead.
I had a quick question about that, because the same speaker I talked of that was talking about the 192 natural frequencies said that one of his theories is that there's apparently two nerves at the end of the tailbone that are their own, I don't know if like it's their own separate chakra, but they apparently hold that violet aura as well, and that is what completes the circle, the toroid, I think it's called. Have you heard anything about that?
It's new, but it sounds interesting.
Yeah, I thought so too. He said that he didn't have a whole lot of information to back it up, but that's his belief from what he's come across. So
nice. So, continuing with the seven. So the number seven seems to be very artificial. It's picked by from not from nature. I don't see any number seven in on Earth in the nature. Yeah, maybe planets, but again, it's really how do you count the planets? The days of the week is also artificial, right? The God introduced the 7-day week, so it is attributed to the Creator, maybe to the Creator of the humanity. So the modern humanity has been created with that number 7 as a key number: 7 chakras, 7 days of the week, 7 notes in the musical octave. It can be also divided into other parts, right? So that's artificial division, which I think went very far, and the whole society was created based on that number 7. So actually, you can, depending how you work your Reiki, you can actually maybe tune into intermediate places between the chakras, and you would still resonate with the chakra. So it's basically you have been trained to focus on heart chakra and feel it, but if you focus above the heart, you would focus on higher heart. If you focus below the heart, you would focus on kind of place between the solar plexus and the heart. So I think it's not as, now I understand, it's not as discrete. Okay, now based on the chakras, I think it comes from India, but again, to India it comes from Atlantis. There was created a society of castes of different level of the society. And what again Manosov teaches according to Atlantean magic, it is the lower caste, the lower chakra is the red chakra. It is the simplest physical existence. And then the first caste of untouchables. What he teaches is that that caste was created in such a way that You incarnate into this caste for the first time. You start there, and if you are killed, then your experience of life does not survive. Your soul becomes recycled. So if you complete the cycle, if you grow, if you live your cycle, if you live the life properly, I mean, without being killed, I guess, fully, you have to learn in each level, you have to learn a certain number of major lessons. In one teaching, he says it's 9. In Kabbalah, it's 9. And in some other astrology, it's 12. But basically, you have to learn this major 9 or 12 lessons per level. And then if you graduate, you go to the second level. So untouchables are untouchables because, in the war, you shouldn't kill them because then they die forever. They are not, the soul is not eternal. And if you graduate to the second level, then later, most of your life experience is conserved even after death. And then you reincarnate, you still keep most of those lessons learned. Now, the second level are traders. And the first level is very strong physically and cannot really speak much. For them, the highest achievement, highest magical upgrade would be to learn how to speak. That's their goal for the raising to the second level. So second level is learning for the whole level, they're expanding their ability to communicate. And that would be the traders, and that would correspond to our commercials on the television. Tons of information, tons of communication, but not very high quality. So, you know, the salespeople, traditionally, they are of that caste, the sales, especially the car salespeople. For them, everybody is a friend. For them, everybody is a friend. And all they do, they talk. And their business is done by making agreements and going around through trading routes. For them, the highest achievement in their level is becoming a fighter. And that's, you know, the high at the level 2.7, 2.8, 2.9, they go to martial arts lessons, and that's for them is magic. That is something magical that is beyond their level, beyond the vibration of the second chakra, of sexual chakra, of sacral chakra. So the main color for that chakra would be orange, right? So, So martial arts, that's the maximum that they can reach in that level of existence. Then they reincarnate as a third caste, which is warriors and government people. So their caste, natural existence for them is fight and hierarchy. And their main way of doing things is just go and take it. So main relation to reality is go and take it. So if the trader, second chakra, meets the resistance, they would negotiate and make a deal. If the warrior feels the resistance, you know, they go and break the wall and make a hole so they can go through. So the door is where they are. They would break the hole in the wall and just go through. So for them, and the warrior is, next chakra is solar plexus chakra, and that would be the color yellow, the sun chakra. And for them, the highest achievement, highest magical learning is the magic already, the magician. So they already understand the magic. They believe that magic exists. They are superstitious. So the magic is not what they do, but it's what they learn during their lessons on the third level. And for highest level of their learning, they go and study esoterics. But when they study esoterics, they study it from the position of the warrior, basically. For them, the whole life is the fight, and they're always in danger. So they learn esoterics in a way that you have to protect yourself, you have to use black magic, you have to protect yourself from the black magic. So that is pretty dark magic that they study. And the next level, heart chakra and above, is the level of magicians, the level of spiritual people, and that's the fourth level. And then the first level of the fourth level is the heart chakra. It is extrasensory abilities, abilities to feel things. And because the heart chakra is connected to the hands, that's where you start being able to do Reiki and to feel energy through hands. It's not Reiki yet. And then the next level, you are able to, 4.2, you're able to actually do something. You're a healer. So next level is a magician, a healer. So that's where you are capable of sending the healing and change other conscious being through your energy. What is interesting is that in Reiki you work through heart chakra, and that's where the soul is attached to the heart chakra through the vibration of the heart chakra, and whatever the images the soul sends you is that translated into what you can perceive, and you can perceive the touch. So you sense Reiki energy through the touch sensations. It's not really that you touch it, but the soul can send it to you through the touch sensations. So for me, it was another interesting discovery. Talk about a few other levels just in a second, but the main thing, I started analyzing everybody around me, where I am, where is my family, where are my friends, blah blah blah, and it doesn't fit. The whole theory doesn't fit too well. And I spoke to my spiritual friends and advisors, and they say it was back in Atlantis. That's how the Atlantis was designed. That was the main experiment of Atlantis. It created the separation. It was artificial veils between the castes. It was artificial veils between the chakras. It was artificial veils between different levels of reincarnation. So it's a big experiment, not only on Earth level, but also on the spiritual level. It was a spiritual experiment. And it created lots of energy, because separation could create lots of energy, but also it created the downfall of the Atlantis. And that's where the cosmic civilization fell down and became destroyed, basically. And that's what we inherited, and I guess the caste system of India and the slavery of the West, slavery of the East, slavery of everywhere, the current separation, it's still inheritance from the Atlantis. But, you know, we are working through that. We are removing those veils and separators, and now it's not as fixed as before. So you cannot define anyone as they belong to the caste of traders, because I know by myself, I'm every caste possible. Especially the trader, yeah. You know, I'm here in spirituality, I'm here in trading, and, you know, in some parts of life, I'm working quite actively through the warrior or government type of their caste. So it's not as fixed. And apparently in one life you can go through multiple lessons. And again, it looks like the lesson plan is not as fixed anymore. Now you are permitted to take lessons from different levels. And as I teach, you know, anyone can become a Reiki healer, so I think it's still true. Even, you know, even if you didn't develop on other levels, you still have that capacity to become Reiki healer and become a healer, a magician healer, and work through that level.
I had a really strange experience the other day. I was just kind of like doing my thing with the sewing and creativity. Sometimes I just stare off into space, you know, with my ideas. And anyways, what I seen when I was staring off into space sort of freaked me out a little bit because I've never seen anything like that. But is what I seen was myself doing something and observing that. And it was kind of a lesson, I guess you might say. But it was so physical, it was just strange, like looking at another dimension of myself. And that was pretty much the experience, but it really has stayed with me.
It could have been the observer part of you. I know in some sciences they talk about that.
But so physical was strange.
Yeah, well, was it like an out-of-body experience? Or you were looking in a window, mirroring back to you?
It was myself, but I was doing something completely different than what I was doing right now, right here, in this timeline. So,
oh, like a parallel universe.
It was really quite different. Interesting. And then I forgot, I also seen this other face pop in, kind of like at the bottom right corner. And I look at the face, and it popped back out. And I thought that was really kind of funny. I don't know, it made me laugh for some reason.
There's a belief. There's a belief out there that when we come to this life, there's pieces and parts of ourselves in other dimensions, or maybe even here on Earth too. But we're like fragmented, and we kind of got to do like the prime creator, bring all our pieces and parts of ourselves back to ourselves, because we are the apex of this reality.
Right, and I'm aware of all that. I've just never had anything like that happen. It was
the
just
actual
really
experience
different.
Of it.
Yeah, very different.
Nice.
Different, strange awakening in a way. It was like reinforcing and learning about, I guess, proof of that.
Well, it's just like Max was saying earlier. He said, or who was it? It was not Max. When what's his name? Rain? Zane. When he was reading earlier about our thoughts, it's we think first and then we have the experience, right? So.
Yeah, maybe the veil was just dissolving.
It was just really unexplainable at that moment because, I mean, I do that all the time because I have to wrap my head around what I'm doing. So I'll stare off into space a lot. It seems kind of strange to some people, but really there's a lot going on in my head. So, and then that's just like what popped up unexpectedly, and it was quite interesting. I watched for quite a while. It was a lesson learned, for sure.
Yeah, it's funny, Valerie, because I've been noticing, like, I watched this amazing documentary called The Spring from the Hands, which I think you would love if you do creative work. It was about this pinch pot maker, and it's just this incredible, like, reflection on life. And I noticed throughout the whole thing, he would stop in the middle of talking and kind of stare out into space. And it's like he's really gathering what he wants to say. He has the heart-mind connection, where it's not just like a talking head where he's just spewing stuff out. He's really searching for it. And then I started noticing that in more and more people who I admire, who I think are sort of enlightened, taking this pause as they speak and just kind of staring blankly for a little. And then all of a sudden it's like they're back. You know, so it's interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I noticed that too. Getting the download. Valerie, here is the image for you. Like in Russia, that is a wonderful time. Actually, it's coming now in the spring when middle side of the Russia around the Moscow, when there is so much snow on the ground. When the spring comes, the snow starts melting and it floods the fields, floods the forests. So like the fish which live in a certain river or certain lake there, or fish or frogs, they're stuck there. But during that flood, everything is kind of united. So you can swim on, the fish can swim from one pond to another, or you can take a boat and travel around different villages. Otherwise, you would be stuck in the dirt. But now you can boat, you know, back and forth, and that would be the main means of communication. And because it's like in the middle of Russia, it's pretty flat. It's kind of, it's not very high. It's maybe, you know, to your knees or around your knee, like few feet, maybe 1 foot, 2 feet, and there are islands. But basically, everything becomes connected. And I think that's what my, you know, that might be illustrating where you are. Your vibration raises, and now it raises above the veil, and you see your other timeline or the future or parallel timeline above the veil, because the veil is not there anymore.
That makes a lot of sense. And the face that popped in and out, I just think it was there to make me lighten up. I don't know, it just made me giggle. It was mm-hmm. it was you know, kind of a chubby little face and smiling, and when I looked directly at it, it just popped out. It's like I'm not supposed to see it quite yet or something. I don't know. It just made me giggle. It was quite an experience, and I really enjoyed it. And so,
hey, Valerie, we're here.
Yeah, kind of like that. Kind of like.
It's nice. You finally can see us.
Bring me back to reality or something.
We're always here. And like, hello.
Yeah,
hello, Valerie, I'm here.
Yeah.
All right, yeah. So I need to start wrapping up. I finished the story. It's a little bit, few more things which I wanted to mention. So basically, he talks about, I don't know translation to English. It comes from many traditions, but basically it's called, in Russia, it's called point of assembly. In Castaneda, do you know how it's called in Castaneda? Anybody knows that point of assembly when the soul attaches that, when you assemble yourself in one chakra or another?
I've heard that term come up a few different times from different ancient traditions, like in indigenous traditions, talking about, I think Don Juan actually, talking about your assemblage point.
Assemblage point.
Yeah, behind your neck area, or maybe even on your right shoulder, but I've heard different variations of it, I think. You have the term, right? Yeah.
All right. Thank you. So assemblage point, it's called. So basically, if you move your assemblage point, it's, you know, it's conscious. It could be conscious. If you move your assemblage point to the heart, then this basically the spirit, the main spirit connection, the main spirit vibration connects to you through your heart chakra. And the easiest way for the spirit to connect to you is through the sending the nerve signals to your fingers. So it's like you are feeling their aura or chakras through the fingers. So that's what we do in Reiki. Now, if you raise your assemblage point to your throat, that is actually channeling, and it's speaking galactic languages. And that's why speaking galactic languages, just bubbling some galactic languages, helps you to open your channeling capacity. It's how the spirit can speak through you. Raising a little bit higher, I think it's still the same area, because speech and the hearing connect to about the same mechanism in the brain. So sometimes when I think, especially when I'm doing like simple arithmetics, the math, I have to use my Russian language processing to do the math, right? So,
hey Max,
so
whenever I like have my higher self come through, I feel that right where you were saying there in your jaw, that gets super, super tight right through there, and then I have popping in my ears. So that's how I know it's my higher self coming through, because every time that's exactly how I feel. That was so funny how you're grabbing your cheeks there on the side by your jaw, and I'm like, ah, that's my spot. But yeah, Tina doesn't know about channeling. If you can explain that a little bit to her.
explain the channeling. What's there to explain? You basically invite the spirit to come through and get into meditative state and let them use your mind and voice, and then they come through and speak for you. Sometimes it's just the message, and sometimes it's more than that. Sometimes it is hard to get them out. If it is a spirit which doesn't want to get out, then they kind of have your body for a while. And then they just leave. So we usually invite very nice spirits, and they are conscious about keeping the body in good shape. And then, we get actually extra healing when they channel through us. So that's channeling. And, we have aliens coming through, angels and spirits, human spirits from the other side, and higher spiritual energies from different dimensions. That's a simple summary. All right. So, and then goes higher, and it's the vision. So that's your, if your point of assembly is around the visual area of the brain, around the third eye, that's you get the visions. I experience, like, when people do Reiki on me, especially the powerful, high vibrational people, I can see the blue light just from nowhere. It's not structured, it's just the cloud of blue, purple light. And it's just, one of the wonderful proofs. It's like really visible. I just see it. It's coming. And I also play this game. It's called Daily Remote View Daily. So every day they send you the image which will be open. Remote view what will be shown the next day, and then next day they send you the image, computer picked image, just a photograph, and sometimes it's a playing card, sometimes it's a president, sometimes it is a donkey, and so on. So very simple images, mostly simple images, and once in a while I get it right, and it feels happy. So and then I analyze, how did I guess it? Where did it come from? Was it on the voice level? Was it on the perception level, like the answer? And recently I started just kind of speaking different answers and feel, how does it feel? That answer feels, and sometimes it feels right. And you open the card, and if it's right, then it works. So that happens, and that's remote viewing, and it's a nice tool to develop your intuition. And then, again, if you... assemblage point is higher, then you would get the answers right from your mind and not see any images. It would be just pure knowledge. And usually that's my way of getting answers. I just ask the question, and sometimes it takes half a minute, sometimes 1 minute, sometimes it takes a night. In the morning I just wake up and I get the answer. So I don't know how it comes there, but that's my way of channeling. I just get the answers, and rarely I hear the sounds or see the images, but it would be just the answers. Yeah, technicals, yeah. So I think I'm done with this Manosov. Well, there is lots more, but that's kind of the main core of... Oh, one more thing. Any more questions so far? I'll switch to the next answer.
I did have a question. One time I was having a healing, someone was doing a massage, and he was, my sciatic nerve was pinched, and I was holding a lot of energy, so he was doing energy work and massage, because he is a massage therapist, and when he was doing that, I had to do certain breathing, because it hurt, and I couldn't show that it was hurting, so when you breathe right, you don't feel the pain as much, and at one point, my eyes were closed, and I could see these clouds of different bright color, like it was in water, just going in front of my eyes. I opened my eyes. There was nothing. I closed my eyes. I could see it, just bright colors. Like, there was gold, there was magenta, there was blue, beautiful green. And it was like on a yellow background, and it was just going by my eyes. And I was relaxed, and I was like, I'll just go with it. I don't know what it was. Was it that something the energy suddenly could flow again, or I don't know what it was.
So how did you see that? It was like, thank you, Makiko. I will be done in a few minutes, so you didn't miss much.
Thank you, Makiko.
See you later. Thank you for organizing. So how did you feel the colors? Was it like quite visible? You had closed eyes and the colors just, well, the whole...
it was very visible. Very visible. It looked so real that I could reach out and touch one of those clouds or bubbles of it looked like water paint going through. But it didn't mix in with each other. It just kept floating through, and it was so beautiful. I'd never experienced that before. And it wasn't just one color when I closed my eyes. It was different colors going by. It was, like, pretty much magical. Mm-hmm. And I was getting a massage, and he was unblocking. At one point, he pushed where my hip is, and pain shot out of my knee, and I told him the pain just came out of my knee. He says, that's good. That means the energy's flowing. Whatever was stuck there, it came out. I have no idea. He's an intuitive massage therapist, and he believes in his way of believing is the same way as Buddha.
Michelle, you want to say something?
Yeah, I was just going to mention that energy, healing energy in general, whether it's sound, whether it's Reiki, whether it's another form of healing, really brings a lot of different experiences to people. It's not like every time you get that done, you're going to have the same experience. Like, I've had so many experiences, whether I'm giving energy or whether I'm receiving energy, and I can, like, leave the planet, you know, like, or I can feel, I don't know how you feel what a color looks like, but I can feel what color looks like. You know, there's so many, it's just, don't be surprised by anything. That's all I was going to say. There are so many ways to experience energy.
I agree, Michelle. I have the same kind of experience, like feeling color, and that is a hard one to explain. But almost every single time I meditate, I see the colors, like you were saying, Tina. I don't think that that's unusual when you're relaxed and you're feeling better. I think that color does come into your mind, and it just sort of floats around and goes together. And then if you were to stay with that and be able to meditate, then you might have had an even more profound experience. So if I were you, it sounds like you have a natural ability to meditate. So work on that too.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I just said that it's often that it's intentional what I do when I do Reiki. I grab the person's head and kind of intend to raise their vibration. And usually I succeed. I talk to them and I raise their moods, raise their vibration, and when I raise their vibration, their whole perception of the world changes. They can understand what I'm talking about, because if I don't do raising, they're still in their other reality, so I need to bring them to the Reiki reality. And it's conscious, and it's part of what I teach, part of what we do during Reiki is to bring them to the Reiki reality where things are possible, which are not possible in their layer of being stuck. So obviously that massage therapist, he brought you somewhere where you were perceiving the colors. You know, some
You're
vibe
right, though,
which opened, which again, no. The level of water raised or level of energy raised, so the whale is not there anymore.
Yeah, and just since learning Reiki myself, I have had so many really nice experiences with healing others, healing myself. Sometimes I totally forget that I can heal myself, and then all of a sudden I'm like, oh yeah, I can do this. I can do this myself, because I've had severe back injuries. I have 2 fusions and nerve pain going down both legs. So
this knowing how to relax that myself and allow healing is a wonderful addition to my life, and I think it would be to anyone's life. If you can, try to book a study in that with Max. They'll be doing another session soon. It's well worth your time, well worth it. I can't say enough about it. It's been an amazing experience so far for me, and it's going to continue the rest of my life.
Ah, thank you. All right, so the final thing I wanted to mention from Manosov's study is that the three chakras, three lower chakras, are directed inside, meaning that they are responsible for health. And the four upper chakras, starting from heart, throat, third eye, and crown, they are directed outside in the outside world. And they change that world, and they perceive that world. So you create the world outside the world. You create your reality with higher chakras, and you create your inner. You create your outside reality with the higher chakras, and you create your inside reality with the lower chakras. So that's why grounding is important for your everything, right? For your everything, and for your health especially.
And for your heart, most especially for your heart. I've had to do some extreme heart healing, and I'm a new person. I can't say that enough. It's just been an amazing ride. The way back can be, I think Michelle can agree with this, somewhat of a roller coaster at times, but it is amazing. It totally is. Well worth it.
Yay!
Yep.
Valerie! Hey, hey, hey!
I had never had Reiki. I had it a couple of years ago, and when I had it, I was like, oh my god, I don't know what this is, but I want this forever, and I want to know how. So getting Reiki and understanding what it does for, what it can do for and to you is just, it's worth, you know, investing in.
Nice. We have most of our classes, some of our classes, the main parts, the main teachings are published right here on this channel. What channel is? Human Colony TV. Just go and you can watch our classes and learn. And of course you need attunement, which would really introduce you to the Reiki spirits, introduce the Reiki spirits to you so you can connect more directly. It's nice to have an attunement and to get that protection which it gives and to get that initiation which it gives. And now I would invite some blessings, and we'll start wrapping up. If anyone wants to do a galactic language or a blessing, and I, at the end I will read more of the ALU sequence, chant more of the ALU sequence, and you can tune into that sequence. I believe it's a higher human upgrade sequence, which is already in us, which we can put in order and activate. How do I say it more profoundly? To structure, to make the DNA, to make our genome more coherent, to make it more orderly, to make it more perfect, to make it more crystalline, to activate, to energize, to fill it with light, sound, electromagnetic energy, and ethereal energy. So invite blessings if anyone wants. Let me first collect who wants to do the blessing. So we.
I don't speak the galactic language, but I would like to do just a short blessing if I can.
Yes, and who else? So we know who is coming. Bree, Michelle, Tina, Zane, are you into blessings?
Yes, I'm native. We do blessings all the time.
All right. Valerie, Tina, anyone else? Zane, do you want to read anything as a, maybe a poetry or a blessing? Mm-hmm. Michelle? Oh, Michelle, you can do your chanting. I liked your chanting when you chanted the sound. It was wonderful. Do you want to do it? Eton? Yes. Loud noises. You can just speak farther from the microphone.
She's just saying loud, but she is good. She is, don't worry about that being too loud, Michelle.
I have the microphone control, so I can adjust. And Bree, are you into blessings?
Okay. How about I start?
Some questions, some awesome blessings to share. Yes. Not today. Okay. All right. So we have... All right. I will just say names. So I will start from Valerie today.
Okay. Blessings, everyone, today. Thank you for joining us on this beautiful day. And thank you, Max, for being here with us and bringing all this wonderful information to us. We are exactly where we want to be right now. We can accept others as they are. We can forgive with our whole hearts open. Healing is happening today and every day. Bless you all.
Thank you. Tina?
Yes. I have a little chant. I have a drum too.
Oh, wonderful.
A song that came to me 10 years ago, and I'm going to sing it in Mi'kmaq, but the words are in English. It's the way we think, it's the way we live our lives that defines what's in our hearts. If we really wanted peace inside, we would show it in the way we live our lives. Okay?
They're beautiful and very, very talented.
Thank you.
It's hard to reflect in words how perfect it was. Michelle, are you into chanting?
I can do toning. I'm not going to...
Yeah, tuning.
All right, let me connect with... Thank you. Namaste.
Wow. Thank you.
Namaste. Thank you, Michelle.
Zane, would you like to join? Zane?
Are you there, Zane? Can you hear us?
Not here. Maybe he's disconnected somehow. I think everybody did it, right? So, Brie, you're not today, right?
Yeah, I'll get there someday. Not today.
All right. Okay, so I will do another chant of the Alu sequence. All right. Maruhata dana yada yana hamaha yaha vahatu vasha. Thank you very much, everybody. I think we are done for today.
Thank you so much, Max. It's been a pleasure in learning everything that you had to teach today.
Thank you. It was fun, and it's you were very helpful to bring this about, and it's nice to create this broadcast. It's nice to connect to the world in this new way.
And thanks for everybody new for joining us, and please come back again. And
yes.
Come back and see on YouTube if you have missed anything.
Right.
Thank you again. And goodbye.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Namaste. Thank you.
Thank you.